Welcome to Wine Library TV. I am your host, Gary Vaynerchuk, and this is Wine Library TV. So we are in part 3 of 12 in the epic marathon of taping WLTV episodes. I think you're going to enjoy as I get more loopy, tired, and lack of energy than an explosion of energy. And it's going to be a very interesting day here at WL as I'm getting comfy in talking about a subject that I think is going to inspire some thought. And that is Pinot Gris. Did you know that Pinot Gris is known as Pinot Grigio in Italy? And so this is a really funny subject matter for me because many times have I helped some customers who, when Oregon Pinot Gris got hot 3 or 4 years ago and everybody was writing about it and everybody wanted to be trendy and cool, bah, you know, people were coming in saying, oh, I want a great Pinot Gris. And yes, we had a couple, but there were some really fat-ass phenomenal Pinot Grigios in the store that I wanted to recommend. And people were like, oh, I don't drink Pinot Grigio. Right. So, you know, it's really kind of cool when grapes take different name forms in different parts of the world and do different things. Chardonnay and Pouilly Foussé is probably my favorite, but Pinot Gris and Pinot Grigio is quickly rounding up. Now, Pinot Gris is extremely interesting. We've got 4 wines from different parts of the world here today, but no Alsatian Pinot Gris, and that's really where its stranglehold is, where it's doing a great job. And we'll save that for an entire episode by itself. We're going a little more New World Pinot Gris today, with one Old World exception. Now, Pinot Gris is a clone of Pinot Noir, and it's very interesting because the grapes are almost gray, gray purplish. They're almost gray purplish, sometimes very dark, though it's a white wine grape. So it's very intriguing grape when you see it hanging. What is that, Cabernet? No, Pinot Gris. Oh, I'm an idiot. You know, that kind of thing when you're in the vineyards. And, you know, gris meaning gray, so that's kind of where it got its name. It's a very interesting clone of Pinot Noir, and it's producing some very profound white wines, some very intriguing white wines. Now, Pinot Gris as a grape has now become the 4th largest consumed grape in the world. Recently, you know, jumping into that 4th place, and that's basically because of Pinot Grigio. But what we're gonna focus on the ones that say Pinot Gris on the label and come from different parts of the world. So let's really focus. Now this is the Nikias 2005 Pinot Gris. You're captivated, are you gonna zoom in here for me? You zoomed in? What did you do? How did you do that? Oh, you did it behind the, I didn't even see it. All right, so weird. This is from Hungary. Now there's a couple reasons why, you know, that this is important. Now, this is 9 bones and it comes from Hungary. And what I wanna see real quick here for you real quick, just give me a second. 12% alcohol content, let me pour this while I look at this. Okay, only 300 cases made of this, but I really wanted to see something. Nonetheless, this is from the Buda region, which is making it interesting right off the bat. Hungary is producing some great wines. You know, obviously we talk about Tokaj and dessert wines all the time, but they're really coming on their red wine and white wine production, and really on the Pinot side. The Pinot Noirs are really good, and the Pinot Gris have been really good. I've never had this, but we've had a lot of success with this wine, so I'm very intrigued to try it. It's $9, which is an absolute value, let's give it a whirl. It's got, you know, a light color, like most Pinot Gris do, and a grand. And again, Pinot Gris are really fun because they're tremendous alternatives to Pinot Grigios, which have become one way, one style, mainly out of Italy, which is really sad. And these are usually nice alternatives to that. So there's a lot of Pinot Grigio drinkers right now out there, I know. And you should definitely, definitely seek these out. Let's give it a whirl. It's got a very interesting, you know, simple kind of nose. There's an interesting kind of... I don't want to say spearmint or peppermint nose, but like a cool winter fresh nose aspect to it. I'm getting some lemon peel. I'm getting a little bit of peach fuzz as well in this, which is really nice. And, you know, I'm enjoying that. Let's give it a whirl. Tastes a lot like raw cauliflower, which is really obvious to me, spritzed with some lemon. I mean, it's like, you know, cauliflower and spritz of lemon, that's exactly what this tastes like. Little heat, little disjointed, little stinky feet going on in the action. Not doing much for me. I'm gonna give it 85 points though, because there is a lot of nice things going on. Let's talk about the positives. It's clean, it's fresh, it's crisp, it's better than 80% of the Pinot Grigio that's coming out of Italy. But again, a little one-dimensional for me, but nonetheless, a nice solid entry level. And it's, you know, if you want to shoot out to a different part of the world, if you've got ancestors from this part of the world, you know, you kind of want to drink your heritage, this is definitely an inexpensive entry to a white, crisp white wine from Hungary. Man, it tastes like the stem of cauliflower so much. I'm really interesting. Let's move on. Now, this is the place where everybody's kind of talking about Pinot Gris. This is from Oregon. This is the Benton Lane 2006 Pinot Gris, $13. And this comes with a screw top. So, you want a little higher? Or you said it was good. You gotta give me a new sign. This is good. This should be higher. That's probably what you were doing. I wasn't paying attention. I'm a jerk. Okay, let's give this a whirl. Now, what's really interesting about Pinot Gris from Oregon, and I should have saved it before I poured this, and now the thing went away. These are about as white wines get. I'm always extremely intrigued, and they get a little frizzante. I mean, look how cloudy this is. The bubbles are coming. Now, unlike many other wines, like champagne, the bubbles quickly go away, and you're left with at least one of the whitest wines you've ever seen. I mean, you want to talk about your friend with the red hair and the real pale skin? That's what Pinot Gris is. It is definitely the red-headed stepchild of Pinot Grigio. Little segue action. Now we're warming up. Let's get focused. 13 Bones, Benton Lane, one of my favorite producers in Oregon, and I'm excited about trying this. Let's give it a whirl. Oregon. 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 All right, so really nice nose, very spritzy, which I appreciate, very fresh. I'm getting beautiful apple core. You know, the apple's gone, it's beautiful apple core. I always wanted to draw apple core in class, and it's one of those things I love to do. That and Bart Simpson. Very, very fresh, very lively, very crisp, very clean. Everything you're looking to do in a white wine that's going to be the anti-Chardonnay, and that's what this is. Let's give it a whirl. This is an acidic explosion. It's really almost taking my teeth and making them shrivel up like a 98-year-old grandma. Very clean. I'm enjoying the beauty of this wine. It's very crisp, very clean. It is good. This is absolutely what I'm looking for in my Pinot Gris. A very clever, clean white wine. And, you know, clever because, you know, through a stink bomb in class. I mean, you know, no, it's just, it's very good. It's very focused, which I appreciate. Getting a little bit of a, almost like a grainy aspect on the finish. I get this grape nuts cereal aspect on a lot of white wines, and I'm really getting it on this wine. Really converts from a real apple cinnamon explosion without cinnamon. Real apple cinnamon explosion without the cinnamon to a grape nuts grain aspect to it. Very, very acidic. It could be too much for certain people. It really shoots the acidity. But I like it. This is a polished wine. The melon flavor is quite obvious on a finish. I'm gonna score this wine 89+. It's not complete enough or special enough to get to that 90-point plateau, but it's right there. And at $13, it's kind of, you know, I wouldn't say it's a pass, but you should seek it out. I mean, it's a good wine. Now, this is really interesting. This is the McMurray Ranch Sonoma Coast Pinot Gris 2005, $14, and really gained, you know, critical acclaim by Robert Parker, 90 points Parker, which is so rare to see for a Pinot Gris. So I'm excited about trying this. Pinot Gris was first planted in Cali in 1966, 3 years before the Jets changed the world. And, you know, definitely it's been around and it's not totally hitting its stride. I mean, Oregon are really getting the credit for Pinot Gris these days in the United States of America. But clearly, Parker believes that this is a very high quality wine, $14, 90 points Parker. Again, clearly a golden color. Let me give Eric a little, there you go, Eric. You know, so it's definitely a little more golden than the prior two wines, a lot more color going for it. Nobody's scared of color, so that's good. Honeydew has found its way back onto Wine Library TV. This time I know what it is. There's also a mustard component to this wine. So, you know, it's really honeydew with, excuse me, yes. How do you enjoy that honeydew? It's fantastic. Would you like some Grape Poupon with that? That's what you're doing with this wine, because it is definitely an absolute pure integration of Grape Poupon and honeydew. Nice. Let's give it a whirl. Getting some Granny Smith apple. Beautiful acidity, very sharp, very focused. Nice richness. A little hollow in the mid palate, and finishes a little short for me. To me, this is not a 90 point wine. This is a little bit more of an 87 or 88 point wine. I find the Benton Lane to be a far superior wine on the premise that it's not as over oaked as this wine. This wine's got a little of that oakiness level. And let me rephrase that. I don't even think it's oak. There's a creaminess to this wine, which is fine, but it almost feels like Pinot Gris is trying to be, you know, Chardonnay. And it's like one of these things. I and Eric are big fans of redheaded women. You know, we like the redheads. And, you know, it always disappoints us when they go and try to, you know, color their hair blonde. Right, Eric? I mean, that's like, be who you are. That's how I feel. What's that?
That's 70s show.
That's 70s show. Right, exactly. I mean, there's endless examples. As a matter of fact, let's list them all, please. Any comments? So, you know, but this is really trying to be Chardonnay to me when it's Pinot Gris. And to me, that is a no-no. Let's go 87 points in this wine. The Benton Lane is a much crisper example, truer. I mean, it's a good wine. There's some nice things going on. I'm kind of going on my principle for the score. But I still don't think most people find this 90 points, except the most powerful, wonderful, best wine critic in the world. Okay, let's move on. The Hua 2006 Pinot Gris. Ooh, they did something cool with their vintage. Eric, focus on this. They did 2006, but the 06 is really big and the 2000 small. Marketing, I like it. The Hua 2006 Pinot Gris from Marlborough, New Zealand. And this wine is $18 US. And I'm excited to try it because one, I'm a fan of Hua. I think they make some really good Sauvignon Blancs. And two, the bottle is skinny and tall. And we all love skinny and tall in America. The perceptions that they push through us with red hair, right? There you go. Very, 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 very crisp and clean looking, clear. Again, only the one that was trying to be a shard looked different. so let's give this an attack. 18 bones, expensive. This better bring the thunder. There's a lot of great Alsatian Pinot Gris that's less expensive than this or in this price point. You know, kind of a subpar nose, not too much going on. I'm getting a little bit of goose and berry on the nose, which I like quite a bit. A little bit of lime instead of lemon, I guess, but very closed. 06, let's give it a whirl. Actually, gorgeous mouthfeel. Exceptional, actually. By far, the most pleasant thing in your mouth out of these four wines, no question. Nice crispness, nice, almost like a clove kind of aspect going on the flavor profile. Nice sense of richness. I think that's what I like about this wine the most. It almost probably does what the McMurray wanted to do by acting like Chardonnay, being a little heavier. This is a heavier Pinot Gris than the other wines. A little less acidic than I'd like it to be. And I have to admit, a little flabby with its like fake pineapple flavor on the finish. Very subtle pineapples though. Tastes like hay. Like real dried up, you know, weeds, things like that. Nice wine, definitely not worth $18. They need to seriously think about focusing on the Sauvignon Blancs. This is not, to me, worth that kind of price point. However, if this was $9 or $10, I'd really be going crazy because just a mouthfeel alone, it's an exceptional wine. I'm gonna go 87 points. You know, it's a solid bottle of wine. And that's 87 points based on its price point. So obviously 87 points to me is a real, 88 points is a really good barometer for a $10 wine, but not for an $18 bottle of wine. So I'm gonna give this wine a pass. It's just not as good as it could have been, I guess. And more importantly, the price does bother me. I mean, it's a good wine, but the price bothers me. And it's not crisp and clean. And that's what I look for in Pinot Gris. getting inspired to do a Pinot Grigio episode. A lot of people have been asking me, actually I'm going to ask you a quick question, it's not the question of the day. I get at least a tenth of the 1,000 emails, so at least 100 emails a day, saying can you recommend do a show on what you recommend at $10? And as you know, I rarely do wines on the show that I've ever had before. I don't want it to be kind of like, oh, I had this, you should try this kind of show. More like, hey, let's discover this together. Where on the fence do you fit? As a matter of fact, that's gonna, no, but I have such a great question today that Eric came up with, so I'm gonna ask that later. So disregard what I just said for the last minute. Question of the day. What did you draw in class in your childhood? Or you might still be in class now. What did you draw? Because you, a little bit of me, we're changing the wine world, aren't we?